In 1939, only 35% of American homes had telephones. That same year, the Futurama exhibit at the World's Fair predicted there would be portable wireless phones in the very near future.
Come here.
And they weren't far off. 3 years later, U.S. soldiers carried the earliest ancestor of the cell phone onto the battlefield, the Motorola walkie-talkie.
And it really was the forerunner of what the future was going to be.
After the war, telephone giant AT&T took the walkie-talkie concept from the front lines to the front seat. But the car phone had its limitations.
If you had an antenna in New York and you had four channels, you only could have four conversations at one time in the whole city of New York.
And in 1947, they came up with a groundbreaking way to expand the system.
Instead of having a big, powerful transmitter on a hill, you would have many, many small coverage areas connected together like a grid.
But they need a frequency for it.
So AT&T asked the Federal Communications Commission, or FCC, to let them develop a nationwide cellular phone system. The FCC turned them down. The cell phone's biggest obstacle was another new technology.
Most of the spectrum, which is the highway that the calls run on, was saved for television.
In 1969, television began the move from broadcast to cable, and the FCC realized they had some airwaves to spare. So they set up a challenge. Whoever came up with the best mobile phone system would get the spectrum to develop a nationwide cellular network. Of course, only one company had the means to do it. So AT&T dusted off their 1947 cellular proposal and pitched it to the FCC one more time.
We called it cellular because it looks like B cells where they fit together.
AT&T was working on this idea of having very low power transmitters. You would have lots of them and they would cover small areas.
As a vehicle drives from one cell to another, advanced electronic equipment automatically transfers the call to another cell without the caller knowing it.